The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
responsive reading of Psalm 148 with the sung response printed in our order of worship. Let us pray. O Lord, we beseech thee, let thy continual pity cleanse and defend thy church. And because it cannot continue in safety without thy succor, preserve it evermore by thy help and goodness.
Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Praise the Lord in the heights.
Praise the Lord, all his angels. Praise the Lord, all his hosts.
Praise the Lord, sun and moon. Praise the Lord, all shining stars.
Praise the Lord, highest heavens, and all waters above the heavens.
Let them praise the name of the Lord, who commanded and they were created.
Who established them forever and ever. Fix their bounds which cannot be passed.
Praise the Lord from the earth, sea monsters, and all deeps.
Fire and hail, snow and smoke, stormy wind fulfilling God's command.
And all cedars.
Beasts and all cattle, creeping things and flying birds.
Kings of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the earth.
Young men and maidens together, old men and children.
Let them praise the name of the Lord, whose name alone is exalted, whose glory is above earth and heaven.
God has raised up a horn. Praise for all his faithful ones, for the people of Israel who are near your God. Praise the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, glorious in God's name.
You may be seated. A reading from the prophet Isaiah. But now, thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in exchange for you. Because you are precious in my sight and honored, and I love you, I give people in return for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east and from the west, I will gather you. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from far away and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
like to invite all the children who are here to join us all on the steps for moments with all God's children. And as they come forward, let us join together in singing the song in your order of worship. Today, and so glad you all are here. Can you turn so I can see all of you today? Thank you. Well, today is a very special day in our church. It's called Coming Home Sunday, and we have a lot of people who are back with us today. We're so glad that they're here. Have you ever thought of your church as being your home? Do you feel at home here? Yeah. A home is somewhere we can live. It's somewhere we feel happy and safe. And one of the most important things about being at home, it's somewhere we're wanted and somewhere we're loved. And I hope you always feel wanted and loved in your church, because one of the most important things about this place is it's where we come to feel God and learn about God. And one of the things we'll hear about in church today is God is at home with us. God wants to be with us, and God loves us. And one thing we're thinking about today is for 200 years, people have been coming together. It's had different names, and it's been in different places. But for 200 years, people have been coming together as a group and celebrating how much God wants to be at home with us. Isn't that cool? I think it's really cool. So today, we're doing all this to celebrate how much God is at home with us and how much we're at home with God. So every time we come together, we celebrate how much God wants us, how much God loves each of you, and how much God loves you. So that's something always to celebrate, whether it's 200 years, 2,000 years, or each Sunday. Isn't that cool? I want to thank all of you for being here, those of you who help sing, those of you who are out in the church, because I could hear you help pray, and I saw you smile as we came in, and that's how we know God is happy, and God loves us, and God wants us to be in his house. So we're so glad you're here today. I want to give you just a couple of instructions. If you're in the choir, I want you to go with your adult helper, and they're going to help you get changed. If you're ages 4, through second grade, you can go with Miss Katrin to children's worship if you want to. And then the rest of you can go to your seats. But before you move, let's have a prayer together, okay? Because prayer is a very important way we spend time with God. So let's pray, and you can repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for a home. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for wanting us. Thank you for 200 years of loving us and us loving you. Help us to always love you and watch over us as we go into your world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, well, thank you all, and I'll see you all later, okay? Well, as we continue our celebration this morning, we have the opportunity to do so by sharing our gifts with our Lord, and I invite our ushers to come forward at this time as we continue our celebration.
Thank you.
We give you thanks for 200 years of ministry through this congregation. Receive these gifts as a sign of our joy and thanksgiving for this church home. May the Holy Spirit bless and use them to bless those who need to know your love and grace near and far, so that all at last may know that their home is in you. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
I invite you to join me now in this prayer for illumination, which is printed in your order of service, followed by a reading from the Revelation to John chapter 21, verses 1 through 7. Let us pray. O God of promise, your word made flesh in Jesus Christ is trustworthy and true. By the power of your Holy Spirit, may it rise up in us this day like a gift from the spring of the water of life to refresh our thirsty souls. Amen. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." This is the word of God for the people of God.
It's my high honor to present the preacher of the morning. But before I do that, I want to pause a moment to recognize some distinguished guests. Aren't we all grateful for these guest musicians and our home musicians? How we have been blessed this morning. And I wonder if you have any idea what it feels like to be in the midst of this distinguished cloud of witnesses, going all the way back to the time of Paul Worley, one of my heroes, because Carolyn and I met in his seminary class on the church and recreation. And then we've got musicians of Bill Gray, Jim Rogers, who's blessed us with your directing and so forth, and our own Tim. Our district superintendent is here, Nathan, God bless you. I know you have many places to be, and we're glad you're here with us. Of course, it's a joy to be with my bishop, Mary Virginia Taylor, who will bring the benediction in a moment. And then I am delighted to present somebody with ties to our very distant past. The granddaughter of R.G. Waterhouse is here this morning with her son, Richard, his son, Richard, and his wife. Would you all just wave? They're over here on the corner. Dr. Waterhouse was pastor here from 1886 to 1890. Then he became president of Emory Henry College. That name, Waterhouse, is all over the Emory Henry campus. And then he became a bishop. And it's so glad, Berta, to have you here today. We are honored by your presence. God bless you. Well, it's a little strange to try to introduce Ken Carter to a congregation that knows him and loves him and respects him so highly. Ken was born in Washington County, Tennessee. He's an honors graduate of East Tennessee State University, Wesley Theological Seminary, and has a Doctor of Ministry degree from Vanderbilt. He served churches in the Bristol area, in the Abingdon area, Concord, and First Church Oak Ridge. You may remember that while he was there, he helped initiate a dialogue between the scientists and the Council of Bishops. And out of that dialogue came one of the most profound studies the church has done together in defense of creation. You know Ken to be a Wesley scholar, to be a profound advocate for racial and economic justice, a concern for the poor and those who live in poverty, and a lover of the church and God's people. You know him as a beloved pastor and as a powerful preacher and as an advocate for justice. I know him as a cherished friend and as a respected colleague in the Council of Bishops. Ken, it's good to have you home. before any of us knew what was going to happen at Church Street, Ken and I were kidding, and we were saying we wouldn't mind being appointed as the co-pastors at Church Street. And I immediately chimed in and said, I would love that. I'll preach, and Ken can look after the administration. But you know that Ken is living now in South Carolina and giving loving care to Linda, who needs special care. He's near his daughters and grandchildren. Ken, it's so good to have you home. Thanks for all you did while you were here. He, like some of the rest of us, didn't get to stay long enough. Bill Fowler still has that record, and it may be a while before it's broken. Hear prayerfully now our beloved friend and colleague, Ken Carter.
Well, he said that Bishop Taylor would pronounce the benediction in a few moments. Are you ready?
Just something I need to do here. Can you hear me now? Let there be sound, and there was sound. What a day. What a service. What an honor to be a participant in this celebration of coming home. Truth be told, I've been homesick for Church Street for 24 years. I left in 1992. And been homesick ever since. I have longed for this beauty. I have yearned for this awe-inspired worship. I have yearned for this splendid music. I have longed for the caring fellowship that characterizes this congregation, for its vitality in mission and ministry, for its radical hospitality extended without race or class. Those of us who have been privileged to be a part of this remarkable congregation will always consider Church Street emblematic of what home means. You know, there is deep within the human psyche a longing for home. In fact, the Bible is the story of the human longing. When our primordial parents were expelled from their garden home, the human family has been searching for home ever since, yearning for home. When the Hebrew people found themselves in Egyptian bondage, God heard their cries, saw their sufferings, felt their pain, and came to deliver them and to lead them home, that promised land we just sang about. And then when the people of Judah were taken off into Babylonian captivity, they longed to go home. They knew that their ancestors had had a home. Remember, Abraham and Sarah went out in their old age in search of a homeland not made with human hands. And now the people of Judah are cut off from their temple, their standard worship experiences, their families, their liturgies, and long to sing the songs of Zion, but didn't know how to sing the song of Zion in a strange land away from home. And it was out of that period comes our first reading for this morning from the Hebrew Scriptures, from the book of Isaiah. Those that mourned in lonely exile, longing, longing, longing for home, wondering if they had been cut off from God. And then there came that prophetic reassurance from the God whose home is among mortals. The God who said, "Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I know you by name. You are mine. And I'm going to take you home." New Testament filled with home stories. Jesus going home to Nazareth. Not a very welcomed homecoming for him. Where he announced his mission in the words of the prophet Isaiah, to bring good news to the poor, release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, and to proclaim the year of Jubilee, where we all go home. And then there's John, living in the midst of empire, exile, amid suffering, longing for home. And there comes that remarkable vision of the new heaven and the new earth, home, where God's dwelling is among mortals, and God, like a loving parent at home, wipes away every tear from our eyes, and death is no more. Frederick Buechner says that there is embedded in the human psyche a longing for two homes. The home of the past, where we were nurtured and launched into life. And the home of the ideal future, where wholeness becomes our experience. That longing for home is in our human DNA. I spend some of every day now among people whose memories are being erased by disease. Many can no longer remember home, family, church, or even God. But amid that tangled recollections and garbled words, there is a universal language spoken. I hear it every day. You can guess what it is, can't you? I want to go home. For some, it's the home they just left. For others, it's their childhood home. For others, as the woman I visited, now ending near the end of her journey at 96 years of age, as I held her hand night before last, she said, I want to go home to Jesus. So home is more than a memory. Home is an experience, a feeling, and the yearning for home is an unquenchable journey of the human spirit. It is part of God's presence, wooing us, loving us, beckoning to us. You are mine. I know you by name. Fear not. What is this longing for home? At Bethany, which is the memory care unit, where I do now serve as my pinnacle of my appointments. In fact, it's not an appointment. It's a volunteer. I'm the pastor at Bethany. You know, Bethany is in Luke's gospel, the home where Jesus felt most at home. Fitting name for a memory care unit. Where we have worship every Sunday. On the wall there is printed this in large letters, home, where stories begin. Home, the longing for home is the longing to begin again. You know, this is a remarkable birthplace of a lot of dreams, a lot of experiences, a lot of relationships, a lot of introductions to home. I'm going to see if I can keep you awake now. If you were baptized here, would you please stand? What a beginning. You remain standing. I want to, if you don't mind. Here you began your identity with that voice from heaven. This is my beloved son or daughter. With you I am well pleased. Your identity as a beloved child of God was announced here, expressed publicly here. If you had your children baptized here, would you stand? Wow. What a beginning this church has initiated. Look at the children of God. Look at the beloved sons and daughters of God that have been presented there and announced. If you were confirmed here, would you stand? It's all right, keep standing. If you were confirmed here, here you began your own personal decision of a lifelong journey toward home, incorporated into the body of Christ. If you were married here, stand, please. Most of you are going to be standing pretty soon. You began a life together in a covenant akin to the covenant God has for us. Well, I guess you could be seated now. But I want to ask these pastors, if you heard the call to ordain ministry here, would you stand? If this was your first appointment as an associate or thank you. I know my hand can't stand too long, so I'll just have it. Why did you come home today? I suspect that you came here today because you wanted to get back in touch with beginning, where it began. But you know, we not only long for those initial beginnings, we long to begin again. Because it's part of the human condition that we all get lost away from home. And we need to come back home. Every prayer of confession is a beginning again. Every act of worship is a beginning again. And as the poet said, I wish there was some wonderful place in the land of beginning again, where all our mistakes and all our heartaches and all our poor selfish grief could be dropped like a shabby old coat at the door and never put on again. Here's the place. It's home. We can begin again. The longing for home is also the longing to belong. We want to belong to something bigger than ourselves. There is deep within the human spirit also that search for, as Viktor Frankl would say, the search for meaning. It's the search to make a difference or to be a part of something beyond myself. Those who were called to ordain ministry, but those who are involved in ministries around the city and beyond, this yearning to be part of something bigger, a bigger story. You see, it is here that we are reminded that we are a part of the story, God's story. It was during one of the community Christmases, I was seated right down there, about 1, 2, 3, 4 pews back, when the processional of the kings, or the wise men, or wise women, made their way toward, do you still have that star that falls toward me? Do any of the people ever outrun the star? We had a man who came to soup kitchen regularly. He was here in the building fairly often during the week too. But he would never look you in the eye. He always had his head down as he walked through the hallway. He was shy, or whatever his story was, he could not look at us in the eyes. But as he came down this aisle toward the manger, he was bearing that gold-wrapped box ever so reverently. His head was up, following Star. I couldn't take my eyes off him. He knelt in front as though it was really Jesus there. For him it was. Ever so reverently, he laid that gift before the manger. Afterward, I said to him as he was taking off his bathrobe and crown, "Carol, you were a wonderful king." And he said, "Yes." And I said, "That's who you are. You're a child of the king." He got caught up in a bigger story outside himself, at least for that evening. We long to belong to something bigger. That's home. We're part of God's story. You can't get bigger than that. We also want to belong to a family that accepts us unconditionally. We are home when we are accepted for who we are. Beloved. So I remember that staff meeting that Jim Bales and I were in, certainly. When we were discussing, it was 1988. I was new here. We were discussing Advent and Christmas. And someone said, "Well, we have two Christmas celebrations. We have the celebration for the children here at Church Street and our families. Then we have a celebration for the folks at Montgomery Village." And someone said, "Why do we have two? Isn't there one Christmas story? One Christ?" And that began Community Christmas, where people like Carol find that they're children of a king and a queen. They find home. The longing for home also is the longing to become, to be part of something bigger than we, but also to know that that something bigger than we has a future. We are part of the present and coming reign of God in Jesus Christ. We come to become more than what we are. Here we get a vision of what we can become. Here we get a vision of what it means to be a child of God, made in the divine image. But here we also get a vision of God's dream for the world. A world where all know their identity as well beloved children of God. A world in which there are no barriers among the human family, but all are one. a world in which justice rolled down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, a world in which all of creation is healed. We long for that home, the new heaven and the new earth. And here's more of the good news. That's the world that's on its way. It's coming. God's going to win. God's going to bring us home. Thomas Aquinas says the human condition is we are wayfarers on the way to God. Maybe we could say we are wayfarers on the way home, for God is home. Today is a stopover place on our way home. Here, you are beginning and beginning again. Look around you. These are kinfolk. You're part of this family. Lift your eyes. God's bringing a new world. Yearning for home. Welcome home.
Let us now join our voices with Christians throughout the centuries by declaring our faith through the historic affirmation. I invite you to stand as you are able as we now state our belief. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and stood at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, and forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life.
Be with you.
Eternal and loving God, we give thanks to you for your goodness through all the years of worship and witness through this congregation, for your grace in calling us to be your people, for your love revealed to us in Christ your Son, for your gift of the Spirit and the joy of salvation.
We give thanks to God
for those who established this congregation first as White's Chapel, for their faith and vision, for their gifts and abilities.
We give you thanks, O God.
For all who have participated in the life of this congregation, for those who have given freely of their prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness, for those whose wisdom guided our congregation.
We give you thanks, O God.
For all who have preached and taught here, for all who have confessed that Jesus is Lord, for all who today in the congregation now called Church Street United Methodist Church give freely of their prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness.
We give you thanks, O God.
Give us the assurance that we belong to your great company of saints. Continue to guide us, that we may know our task in this place and in the world today, through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen.
Let us pray now for memory and for vision. O Lord, we pray to remember from whence we come, to remember that we compose great works of music and erect great cathedrals of stone and lift high into the air above our heads great sacred stories in stained glass, because there is something of the divine in us, in each and every one of us. In the image of God, God created them, we say. What beauty and dignity and responsibility we have received from your hands, O Lord. Help us to remember these your gifts and to embrace them. When we find them not in the world around us, remind us that we might find them within ourselves. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for ears to hear and eyes to see that which is real. In a time of manufactured reality and an onslaught of distractions, we are in danger of wasting our lives and wasting our time on hand-wringing, fruitless thinking, and misspent energy. Help us to absorb this incredible truth that we are called to be a part of something bigger than us, a bigger story. The calling is sometimes difficult, it is true, but today we remember that for 200 years, the mothers and fathers of this faith community have wrestled with God and have seen God, and they have received new names and lives from God, like Jacob at Peniel, who became Israel. Help us to see that which is real and to claim it, Lord, in your mercy. We pray for a vision of what might yet be. What good work is there still to be done? We need reassurance, O Lord, that when the work seems endless, when there are always more hungry mouths to feed, always more injustice and poverty and cruelty and hypocrisy, that this is not cause to despair, but simply evidence that the story is not yet completed. We need to be humble on a day like today. God, save us from false pride in what we are tempted often to call our church. But we must also hope and dream and dare great things, expecting further adventures, new epiphanies, and more helpful work in the world. Help us always to be on the road to becoming the Church of Jesus Christ, a community of faith for whose presence the world is truly a better place. Lord, in your mercy. When we are lost and in despair, we sometimes say, how did we end up here? Perhaps we fear at times that we have failed or that our church has failed. For this generation and for generations to come, bring us, O Lord, to that place in which we find ourselves lost, not in confusion and despair, but lost in wonder, love, and praise, where with full hearts, full of joy, we might cry out, how did we end up here? We pray, remembering our home, looking forward to our home, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us these words, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. A few practical matters as we prepare to conclude this service of worship. Immediately following the service, the festivities will continue in that we will celebrate a feast in our church gym. If you're wondering how to get there, there's a door immediately to my right. That's the most direct path to go straight through this door, straight down the stairs, straight across the breezeway, straight down the hall. We would like to ask respectfully that those individuals who've made reservations to eat be seated first at the luncheon. So if you have not made a reservation, we ask respectfully that you take just a moment. And if our gym becomes filled to maximum occupancy, which, looking around, I think will probably happen, then we will begin seating people in our parish hall, which is immediately downstairs beneath the nave here. All of which is to say, it may take us a few minutes to get to home. This particular home on this particular occasion. We may be wayfarers in this moment just for a few minutes. So please bear with us in that. The good news is, among other things, I promise you, when you are seated at last, the food will be excellent and the company will be excellent. One last thing. After we sing our closing hymn and receive a benediction from our bishop, Mary Virginia Taylor, we're going to ask you to be seated one last time for the closing voluntary, which I know you'll want to hear and enjoy. Standing now as we sing together hymn number 66.
Go through life refreshing many, as a healing sign for all, through the one who is life eternal.
Thank you.